all those people will need to be employed. And, and it may be that normally can be a system where you just let them go find a job and the market will ensure that they have got a job which is appropriate, which given their skill, will also put them into a job and which will reward them and occupy them. But that may break down really, and to say, no, you get, everybody gets money, and then some of you will have jobs of the conventional sign, and some of you will have to do, you have to spend your time being autistic, you will have to do other things. What you make local, local agriculture is becoming more and more, lots of areas becoming a thing, because people like to have local projects, so they can imagine things shifting. So actually, like working on a local farm is something that is different from being in a coal mine, but actually, as long as you are respected for doing it, then it'll work. So I think that the idea of universal basic income is interesting, and it all hinges on whether as a culture we can respect the people who end up doing different things, who end up not, who are creative and are not, don't earn their money directly dollar for dollar, but are given it, but are given the time to be in separately. If we can, if our society can learn to respect those people and to make them, help them respect themselves, then maybe we will be able to find our way around that. So that one though, I'm gonna leave that now there, because I'm gonna move on, because even though I suppose numerically people are talking about autonomous cars taking Uber drivers' jobs as the big crisis to come, and it is quite a crisis, but when you look at the effects on society of that change, it's from the job which is being done is a fairly straightforward job. Yes, it requires a brain at the moment, the robot will be able to replace, but it's a fairly straightforward, and crucially, it doesn't involve enacting values. Just look at what happens when the machines get smarter and they move on, and they start to replace, for example, newspaper editors. Take newspaper editors, lawyers, doctors, to a certain extent, as they get smarter, if you think about the role of the newspaper editor in today's world, they're actually really in demand, because there's lots of people out there. They're more in demand than they were a year ago, because a lot of people out there are demanding better quality news, better quality information. And there's this crucial role of deciding what's going to be on the front page, and which of these stories, do we need to give a, do we need to give both sides of the story? Or which is it where there's only one rational scientific side of the story, the other side is junk? Which of these, those sorts of decisions about what should take precedence, what is actually true, basically are made by journalists. And there may be that to be able to do a good job, journalists will start bringing in AI to go do the fact check. You can imagine, bit by bit, building an AI which learns to build a really good front page and builds a really good paper, builds a whole online system of news and truth. And so in that case, what's happened is that the AI is moved to a job where it's making a decision. We're making a decision on behalf of society. All the people who read the newspaper in that case. Take the case, there are algorithms which people will be looking at. When you're wondering whether to let somebody out of prison, then the critical question is, are they likely, what's the recidivism likely? What are they like? Are they going to go straight back into jail after a lot of expense of them committing a crime and being caught again? Or are they going to be reformed and stay out of jail? And if you can make, it is much better for the people who are in jail and you're thinking about releasing, than obviously for all of us in the system and the people around the prisons, if the decision is to, is likely to end up straight back in, I mean, really, really well, really, really effectively. So it's the sort of thing which cries out for people to use AI. and people are, have been using the algorithms, that sort of thing. And it's one of the areas where the AI algorithms have been questioned, because it looked as though they weren't being fair when it comes to black people and white people. It wasn't when people went back over themselves, they said, surely this isn't being fair on black people. And what happened, I gather, it was just a cool talk about this. What happened was that when people looked at it, actually then, when the mathematicians look at it, the question of fairness, it turns out that there isn't such a thing as simply defined fairness for algorithms. Actually, depending on how you look at it, depending on how you measure it, you end up with different results. And then there was John Kleinberg, who apparently came up with a mathematical proof that if you had an algorithm which was fair by method one, it could not be fair by method two. So when people say, we must make sure that the system is fair, that's the tip of a very big iceberg. And particularly when, of course, the machine learning algorithm has been, to a certain extent, generating itself, it's to a certain extent, it's reasonable for people to say that, to claim, wait a moment, I didn't discriminate against black people. I took the algorithm out of the box. I plugged it into all the previous decisions that have been made. And the response may be, all the decisions you've been made have been done by white people, and they're totally unfair, so you train the machine on a bunch of unfair data. That may be the case. That's one of the failure modes. Another failure mode is when it's not actually, all I did was I pointed at the people who I'd given, all the people we'd given mortgages to, I just fed them their details, and I fed them the question of whether they defaulted on the mortgage, and it just figured out after a while, to me it's a black box, it just guess who's gonna to default on their mortgage better than we could, so we just do it, but we never told it anything about black people. Well, my friend, let me take you inside. Let's go down inside this multi-layer neural net. Let's see where all of these neurons have been firing. Yeah, it's kind of hard and really difficult, but actually, look, this algorithm has discovered black people by itself. This neuron is firing every time you have a black person. What's it driven by? It's driven by where they live, and it's driven by sort of that name. I guess it's from the letters of the name, and it's just, who do know? But I guess it's in that too. But anyway, it's got the concept of black people. It's then not being able to learn the concept of black people itself, and then it's decided that, in fact, they're not such a good bet for it. So in that case, what's that? Tricky. Very tricky. Particularly when you're isolated.